Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Enneagram Guide to Waking Up. Find your path, face your shadow, discover your true self. By Beatrice Chesnut, PhD, and Uranio Paes, MM. Foreword by Daniel J. Siegel, MD. Narrated by Elizabeth Wiley. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to diagrams present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Foreword. In this lovely and practical introduction to the Enneagram, Beatrice Chesnut, PhD, and Uranio Paes explore the 9 core personality patterns and how they shape and inform our lives. These patterns are the source of many important mental, emotional, and behavioral habits, which affect who we believe ourselves to be and how we engage with life. By grasping the full significance of those patterns, you can achieve a higher level of self-awareness and the emotional freedom that comes from seeing and breaking free from unconscious defenses. Each chapter will help you see those defenses in action, and each provides a step-by-step guide to waking up. By waking up, we mean lessening the constraints of self-limiting habits that motivate feelings, thoughts, and behaviors. We all have such habits. They can be very hard to see because they have become so familiar and comfortable over the course of your life. Why? Because they are deeply embedded in the ways our minds have learned to make sense of the world and our relationships with others. The Enneagram Guide for Waking Up provides valuable tools for bringing these patterns to awareness. In the process, you can develop a fresh understanding of your personal story, including the joys and traumas of your childhood, and how that story informs how you function as an adult. Like Chesnut and Paes, we also view individual personality differences as a combination of nature and nurture. Our innate inheritance and the ways in which our unique life experience shapes us. And our Enneagram study also began with the pioneering work of David Daniels, MD, and Helen Palmer, and their Narrative Enneagram School. In our own work, we examine these personality patterns in the context of interpersonal neurobiology. We consider how they may emerge through systems of mind that enable us to operate in the world as we seek safety and certainty, connections with others, and a sense of agency and power in our lives. We share the view that a deeper understanding of these patterns can lead us to grow into better human beings. This, after all, is the original purpose of the Enneagram. Many people who encounter the Enneagram seek clear guidance on what to do to further their growth once they identify their core Enneagram pattern. This book offers answers, grounded in Bee's and Uranio's many years of working with the Enneagram as teachers and practitioners. We appreciate the way this book builds on the solid foundation of the teaching of David Daniels and Helen Palmer to clarify how each type of person can apply the information provided by this remarkable tool to grow beyond the level of ego or personality at which we get stuck moving through life on autopilot. To make the most of the valuable information offered in this book, we urge you to approach it with curiosity as well as commitment. Our minds are fascinating. Changing them involves work, to be sure, but don't neglect the opportunity to enjoy the journey of growing and expanding through this exciting approach to self-discovery. The mindful strategies and wise advice contained in this approachable guide will help you create more freedom and richer relationships in your life and more peace in our world. Daniel J. Siegel, MD, author of The Developing Mind and Parenting from the Inside Out, and The Patterns of Developmental Pathways Group. The Patterns of Developmental Pathways Group is a team of five medical and social scientists, Daniel J. Siegel, M.D., Laura Baker, Ph.D., David Daniels, M.D., 1934 to 2017, Denise Daniels, Ph.D., and Jack Killen, M.D., who have been exploring the Enneagram's personality patterns from the perspective of contemporary science for over 10 years. A book describing their work is forthcoming. Introduction. The only person you are destined to become is the person you decide to be. Ralph Waldo Emerson. You are not your personality. But who are you? If you're like most people, you picked this book because you want to understand more about why you are the way you are. Why do you do the things you do or react the way you do to certain things? Why, no matter how many times you think you've learned something, do you keep making the same mistakes? How can you make your relationships better, and what happened in the one that didn't work out? Why is there one issue in your life that you just can't get past? Well, there's a reason for all of these things, and there's a reason why you have a difficult time understanding why you do what you do. Basically, you have become a zombie. No, we're not saying you're literally one of the undead. We're saying you're going through life in a zombie-like state, on autopilot, asleep to who you really are and what's really going on inside you, just like most of us do. This book can help awaken you from this state by introducing you to the Enneagram, a powerful growth tool based on timeless wisdom that can help you come to know your true self. The Enneagram can free you from defensive, self-limiting patterns and help you grow into an expanded version of yourself. It can show you who you really are by showing you who you think you are. Only then can you know who you actually are and who you are not. What is the Enneagram? The Enneagram is a complex and meaningful symbol that relates to many different systems of knowledge, including psychology, cosmology, and mathematics. It forms the basis of a highly accurate typology that describes 9 distinct personality types and serves as a sense-making framework for understanding the human ego and mapping out a process of growth. As a psychological and spiritual model that lays out specific paths of self-development, it helps us wake up to ourselves by revealing the habitual patterns and blind spots that limit our growth and transformation. The Enneagram is based on 9 personality types, grounded in 3 centers of intelligence that determine how we take in and process information from the outside world. We think and analyze using our head center. Types 5, 6, and 7 are dominated by this center, and their experience is shaped by thoughts. They are analytical and imaginative, and know how to plan and make sense of things, but they can be overly logical and detached from feelings and emotions. We feel emotions and connect with others using our heart center. Types 2, 3, and 4 are dominated by this center, and their experience is shaped by feelings. They are usually emotionally intelligent and empathetic, and value connection and relationships, but they can be overly focused on image and fear rejection. We experience life through our senses using our body center. Types 1, 8, and 9 are dominated by this center, and their experience is shaped by sensations. They are usually committed and responsible and value truth and honor, but they can be judgmental and inflexible. We get out of balance when we use one of these centers more than the other two. The Enneagram helps us become aware of and redress this imbalance. Each of the 9 types on the Enneagram circle can be defined in terms of a central survival strategy comprised of habitual patterns and motivations. We all develop unconscious strategies to avoid pain and discomfort as we move through the world. When we see ourselves as the sum total of these unconscious patterns, we lose sight of who we really are and what's possible for us. The fact that these strategies are unconscious makes it hard or impossible to acknowledge and move beyond them. But we are actually much more than we think we are, and the Enneagram helps us to realize this. Each of the 9 personality types on the Enneagram circle has 3 distinct subtypes, making for a total of 27 types. These subtypes are more nuanced versions of the original 9 types and are defined by 3 instinctual drives: self-preservation, social belonging, and sexual one-to-one fusion. Each subtype reveals how these instinctual drives shape behavior and express our core emotional motivations. For each type, the 3 subtype personalities take slightly different shapes, including one of the 3 called a countertype that goes against the general expression of the type in some ways, because the emotional driver and the instinctual goal go in opposite directions. To unlock the amazing insights of the Enneagram, you must first identify which of the 9 types best matches your personality. Then identify the subtype that most accurately describes you. This can be a challenging task, however, because different types look similar on the surface, and you may identify with more than one. The fact that the type descriptions refer in part to unconscious habits or blind spots makes the task all the more challenging. At one level, these personality types are based on a very simple thing: where we focus our attention as we move through the world. But what we see also defines what we don't see, as well as the fact that we don't see it. These are our blind spots. When we remain unaware of these key aspects of our experience, we stay blind to the impact they have on how we think, feel, and act. And this explains why we can be said to be asleep, going through life like zombies. To wake up from this state, we must confront the ego, as well as the shadow cast by the ego. We need to become aware of the automatic habits that structure our defensive egoic persona, as well as all that remains unconscious in us, connected to our ego's need to protect itself. This self-protective persona keeps us focused on its needs and prevents us from feeling pain or joy, condemning us to a kind of waking sleep in which we don't know who we are and what's possible for us. We suppress these shadow elements because they create pain or challenge our self-image. By making these elements more conscious, however, we become more self-aware and whole. Without facing them, we can never know ourselves as we actually are. When we don't see and own the unconscious tendencies connected to the personality we stay focused on and limited by, we are held hostage to who we think we are, or who we fear we are, or who we would like to be. When we move beyond the ego and actively engage in the process of growth that the Enneagram maps out for us, we begin to awaken to our full potential. Making and waking a zombie. Over time, we learn to equate all of who we are with the ego, creating a kind of false self or persona. We each come into this world as a unique and authentic self. As dependent children, however, we adopt survival strategies to help us adapt to our environment. We find ingenious ways to navigate through life, using coping strategies to protect ourselves as small beings in a big world. These unconscious strategies determine to which of the 9 personality types we belong. But you and your personality are not the same thing. Our personalities help us survive childhood, but limit our conscious awareness of all we can be in adulthood. Slowly, over time, our need to survive in the world causes us to develop false selves that stand in place of our true selves. And the farther we get from childhood, the more our true selves are obscured by the defensive patterns we adopt. We become trapped in these invisible, habitual patterns, and it becomes difficult to grow beyond them as they become more deeply ingrained. They become fixed and rigid in ways we don't recognize, precisely because they help us adapt and survive, in some cases under difficult conditions. As we become more comfortable with these strategies, we descend deeper and deeper into a zombie state without even knowing it. The Enneagram helps us understand how the survival strategies we develop early in life can turn us into zombies later in life. It gives us techniques for consciously and intentionally awakening so we can come to know our true selves. When we fall asleep to our true selves and our enormous potential, we lose sight of our innate capacity for growth beyond the ego. We get stuck at a low level of consciousness and forget that we can choose a higher state of awareness. Awakening to our true selves and moving toward this greater consciousness requires an enormous amount of intentional effort. We must become aware of our zombie-like state and then actively work against it in order to rise above it. We must engage in intentional, conscious inner work to awaken from the trance we enter when we think we are our personality. We must continually remind ourselves to be more present and attuned to our moment-to-moment experience to overcome the deeply rooted habits of the ego. Without this conscious effort, we can remain zombies all our lives, and many people do. The Enneagram can help us understand the patterns and tendencies that may be blocking our own awakening. How to use this book. Each chapter in this book describes a distinct path of transformation for one of the 9 personality types. Each traces an individualized journey from realizing problematic, egoic patterns to specific steps in the process of self-discovery to experiencing more freedom from self-limiting constraints. You needn't listen to this book from start to finish. You can skip straight to the chapter you think best describes your personality type. Finding your type can be a valuable learning process in itself. First, try to discover your type using the checklists given at the beginning of each chapter and reflect on which type fits best with what you know about yourself. Confirm what you find through a deep exploration of what feels most true for you. Get input from people in your life whom you trust to help you see your blind spots. Try not to distract yourself from your developmental journey, however, by becoming too focused on diagnosis and description. No one piece of data will give you the final answer. You have to put all the pieces together. Once you find your type, it may show you aspects of your personality that you don't want to acknowledge. Have the courage to own these traits. Some people see the Enneagram as negative. Understandably, they feel implicitly judged by it, but you aren't being judged, and you must not judge yourself. Cultivate self-compassion. The Enneagram is about understanding the truth, and the truth can hurt. It's hard work to wake up, and it's natural to avoid feeling pain. But you must feel your pain in order to awaken. Each chapter begins with an allegory that introduces the key themes of the type. We then describe a three-stage path to transformation, as well as the blind spots and pain points you may encounter along the way. To make progress on this growth journey, we provide specific suggestions for how you can leverage the insights you gain about your type to further your growth. The transformational power of the Enneagram comes in part from what are called wings, the two personality types that are adjacent to your type on the Enneagram circle, and arrows, the lines that connect you to two other personality types on the circle. The wing points suggest gentle developmental steps you can take, while the arrow lines indicate more radical developmental shifts you can achieve through conscious intention. After you learn to become more aware of the unconscious tendencies of your main type, you can create further conscious growth shifts beyond your type's fixed perspective by integrating the healthy qualities of these adjacent and opposing types to embody more of your true self and move forward on your path. Each chapter also describes a paradox that is grounded in the polarity between the passion that acts as the core emotional driver of the type and the virtue that represents its higher level awareness. Each type's passion reflects a kind of zombie addiction to seeing the world through the lens of this core emotional driver. Each virtue represents the goal toward which the type travels on its path of transformation. You move forward on your path by integrating your shadow, the darker aspects of your type, and the habitual patterns and blind spots that characterize it. The original meaning of the word passion is to suffer. Thus, your awakening comes in large part from the conscious suffering you endure as you face your shadow. The Enneagram addresses the challenges we face as we try to awaken to our high side. It maps out the ways in which we function and gives us tools to become consciously aware of the ways in which we sleepwalk through life. We all become zombies by forgetting who we really are, but each of us becomes trapped in a specific set of unconscious habits. The chapters that follow highlight the ways in which each of us can take our own unique journey of awakening and learn to rediscover our true selves. Embark on your journey and enjoy the adventure. The Enneagram Guide to Waking Up. Type 1. The Path from Anger to Serenity. Your best teacher is your last mistake. Ralph Nader. Once upon a time, there was a person named One. He came into this world as a spontaneous child, ready to appreciate the inherent perfection of life. Completely serene and accepting, he felt free to experience joy and fun in everything he did. He took things lightly and flowed flexibly with life, with himself, and with everyone around him. But early in life, One had a painful experience of feeling criticized. When this happened, he felt pressured to conform to others' standards of good behavior. One unconsciously tried to cope with the pain of feeling judged and punished by proactively monitoring and criticizing himself before others had a chance to. He internalized the standards others applied to him and tried to be good and do the right thing all the time. He began to feel that he had to be perfect to be seen as worthy, and that he had to work hard to control himself in order to be good. In his quest to be good, one developed an ability to notice and correct his own errors, to see how everything he did could be more perfect, and to determine what needed to be improved in the world around him. He worked hard to uphold the highest standards of good behavior, and he judged people harshly who didn't follow the rules. He became excellent at making things excellent, including himself. He evaluated everything he saw in terms of how bad or wrong it was, most of all himself. Over time, one became very good at being virtuous and avoiding mistakes. He found the best ways to do things and adhered to all the rules of good behavior all the time. He criticized himself whenever something turned out imperfectly, which was all the time, and he tried to do better the next time. But in the process of getting better and being better, one lost touch with many aspects of himself. He stopped feeling or doing anything that might have even the smallest chance of being considered wrong. He lost most of his awareness of his instinctual impulses, his feelings, his creativity, and his spontaneity. He lost touch with his own inner sense of what felt right, but might be judged as wrong. By imposing strict limits on himself, one learned to avoid anything that could possibly be wrong, including his own deepest rhythms, wishes, and dreams. He often became very angry when others didn't follow the rules, but instead of expressing his anger, he hid his feelings and tried to be nice. He prioritized being ethical, reliable, and responsible in everything he did. He felt compelled to control everything he possibly could to make sure that he got things right every time. And he punished himself when he didn't. His survival strategy wouldn't let him do anything else. And he felt irritated about that, too, but couldn't let anyone know that he felt irritated. What one didn't realize was that everyone around him did know he was angry, because when he enforced what was right, he often stomped around or banged his fists on the table or talked in a sarcastic tone of voice. It became part of the way he operated when in survival mode. He didn't necessarily like it. In fact, it was very hard on him. But he couldn't stop it. He couldn't acknowledge his anger because being angry was not good. Sometimes he felt tired and sad as a result, almost letting himself feel. But what could he do? One eventually became completely deadened to any real sense of himself. He fell asleep to his own inherent goodness, a goodness that revealed itself in his good intentions and his genuine desire to be a good person. He could only keep following the rules and working hard to meet the highest standards in everything he did. But he also completely lost awareness of his deeper human need for fun and relaxation, as well as his basic human wish to be bad once in a while. One had become a zombie, a very polite, appropriate, rule-following zombie, but a zombie just the same. Type 1 Checklist. If most or all of the following personality traits apply to you, you may be a Type 1 personality. You have a harsh inner critic that monitors what you do and operates most of the time. You are sensitive to criticism from others. You naturally sort perceptions into good or bad, right or wrong. You try hard to be good and to do the right thing. When you look at almost anything, you automatically see how it could be improved. You easily notice errors and want to correct them. You follow the rules all or most of the time. You think the world would be better off if everyone did the same. You think and talk in terms of shoulds and musts. Most or all of the time, you believe duty has to come before pleasure. You place a high value on being a good, responsible, and reliable person. You have high standards for yourself and others. You are an advocate for self-improvement. You over-control your emotions because you believe it's inappropriate or unproductive to express them or act on them. You over-control your impulses for fun and pleasure. You believe there is one right way to do everything, which happens to be your way. You have strong opinions and readily express them. You value the rare occasions on which something you do or see feels absolutely perfect. This inspires you to keep striving to make things as good as they can possibly be. If, after using the Type 1 checklist, you find that you are Type 1, your growth journey will follow 3 steps. First, you will embark on a quest to know yourself by learning to identify personality patterns connected to the need to be right, do the right thing, and improve yourself and the world around you. Next, you must face your shadow to become more aware of unconscious patterns and tendencies that stem from your need to feel worthy and virtuous to quell a basic sense of anxiety or prove your inherent goodness. This helps you recognize all the ways criticism and self-criticism are actually holding you back. The final stage of your journey involves moving toward the high side of your type by relaxing your need to be good and accepting your natural human impulses. When you do this, you begin to recognize the inherent goodness in yourself and others and appreciate imperfection as part of the organic flow of life. People will do anything, no matter how absurd, in order to avoid facing their own soul. C.G. Jung. Embarking on the quest. If you are a Type 1, the first stage of your path of awakening involves learning to observe yourself more consciously. This means developing the ability to notice your specific habits of judging yourself and others without judging yourself further for judging. Your growth journey will involve acknowledging how much attention you pay to correcting errors in your environment, monitoring and criticizing the things you do, and resenting what others are doing that isn't right. To further your journey, you will need to work to feel less responsible or overly responsible for making sure things happen the right way. Begin to respect your emotions and impulses, and develop a greater capacity for compassion for yourself. By learning to recognize when you are overly focused on self-improvement, how you try to be good and avoid being bad, you advance down the path toward greater self-knowledge. Key Type 1 Patterns. To embark on your journey, focus on and make more conscious these 5 habitual Type 1 patterns. Criticizing yourself. Notice if you have an inner critic, an internal voice or sense through which you continually monitor yourself and others. That voice provides critical commentary about what's happening, judging everything as good or bad. You may tend to be unaware of the consequences of this self-monitoring, especially when your inner critic is harsh, which it will be, you likely ignore the physical, emotional, and mental tension this critic causes when it enforces what it defines as good behavior at the high cost of increased stress. Requiring perfection. You put pressure on yourself to meet very high standards, and this can lead to tension or procrastination when nothing ever seems good enough. Your focus on imperfection generates a negative attitude about life and may cause you to make people feel criticized or judged. You probably find it hard to relax, enjoy what's happening, and celebrate successes when your judging mind continually dwells on how the results you achieve could be better or more perfect. When you recognize this, you can begin to refocus these thoughts and move toward a more positive attitude. Following the rules. Observe yourself to see if you rigidly adhere to rules, routines, structures, and processes, and you create rules for others as well. You may become angry when people don't follow the rules in the ways you think they should, or adhere to your standards of correct behavior, though you likely avoid fully acknowledging your anger. You may rather experience this anger as resentment toward people who do bad things you would never allow yourself to do. Why are they free to do whatever they want when you can't? Notice if you tend to display a similar rigidity concerning ethics, morals, and work. Sacrificing pleasure. You probably work too hard and find it difficult to make time to relax. Does work always have to come before play for you? Observe yourself to see if it feels challenging to try to stop controlling everything and just flow with the rhythm of life. You have likely forgotten or ignore the early experiences that made you feel as if you had to suppress your desires. Notice if you conform to a set of unquestioned rules, but don't fully realize how stressful it feels to hold yourself to such high standards. You hesitate to pursue pleasure or allow for leisure time to just enjoy yourself. Controlling emotions. When you do somehow allow yourself to express feelings and instinctual reactions, you likely do so with a lot of self-criticism and self-blame. When you avoid being aware of anger, notice if that anger leaks out as partially repressed feelings like irritation, frustration, annoyance, self-righteousness, or body tension. When you find yourself judging emotions as unproductive or inappropriate, see if you tend to rationalize your tendency to suppress them, citing good reasons to over-control your feelings. Notice if you judge yourself and others as bad for expressing anger and other emotions as a way to enforce your habitual avoidance of your feelings. At the core of all anger is a need that is not being fulfilled. Marshall Rosenberg. The Type 1 Passion. Anger is the passion that drives Type 1s. It often manifests as a preoccupation with self-judgment and striving to be good. As the core emotional motivation of this type, anger usually appears in a contained or partially contained form. Type 1s often don't express it directly, because they feel motivated to suppress it and direct it mostly at themselves. They avoid communicating anger because they prioritize the need to be good and believe that anger makes them bad. This anger can thus be understood as a state of upset or displeasure that people or things are not as they should be. Type 1s usually don't experience themselves as angry in an obvious way, however. Their survival strategies focus on goodness, virtue, and correctness, so they tend to control their underlying anger, to the point of not even seeing themselves as angry. In their drive to be good and express what is appropriate according to conventional social norms, they try not to be aware of their anger, sometimes over-controlling it without realizing how angry they really feel. When we suppress our naturally occurring emotions, however, they don't go away. So when type 1s unconsciously avoid feeling their anger, it nonetheless leaks out in repressed forms like criticism, annoyance, irritation, frustration, or self-righteousness, reflecting an intolerance of how things are. It creates an emotional atmosphere of dissatisfaction and unease when they can't change things to be more just, more perfect, or ideal. It may also leak out in physical ways, as tension held in the body or a particular tone of voice. If you identify with this type, here are some typical manifestations of your anger that you must observe and make conscious to move forward on your path to awakening. Determined and watchful overseeing of what's happening. Self-criticism and criticism or judgment of others. Efforts at improvement or self-improvement, as well as attempts to regulate, control, or correct what's happening to make it conform to an ideal or high standard of quality. Direct or indirect expression of annoyance, irritation, or frustration. Passive-aggressive behaviors. Self-righteousness, advocating or fighting for social justice or political reform, efforts to do the right thing or set things right. Shame, guilt, or self-blame, activities of the superego. Body tension and physical rigidity. Sarcasm and mocking or critical tone of voice. Being honest may not get you a lot of friends, but it'll always get you the right ones. John Lennon. Using type 1 wings as growth stretches. The two types adjacent to type 1 on the Enneagram circle are types 2 and 9. By reaching toward the healthy qualities of 9, type 1s can become more adaptable and learn to relax. By integrating the positive traits of type 2, they become more adept at relationships. This moves them beyond their usual focus on maintaining high standards and working to achieve an ideal of perfection, and helps them understand their habit of characterizing things in terms of right and wrong and good and bad. First, adopt type 9's ability to go with the flow, adapt to the agenda of others, and relax and just be. Develop an ability to create harmony in your environment by noticing points of agreement rather than difference with people around you. Find common ground when interacting with others, and expand your usual viewpoint from what could be improved to what already works well. Spend more time listening to others' opinions and less time asserting your own. Consciously work against your tendency to judge by appreciating and supporting what's going on around you without finding fault with it. Prioritize others' right ways of seeing or doing over your own and allow yourself to enjoy connecting with those around you. Then integrate type 2's ability to focus less on tasks and processes and more on people and relationships. Develop an increased capacity to create rapport with others by expressing interest in them, tuning in to how they feel, or sharing your emotions. Communicate with people according to how they feel or what they want, and be more flexible and diplomatic when collaborating with others. Balance your tendency to evaluate and judge with an ability to sense what others need and find ways to provide them with resources or support. Make it an intentional practice to see the best in others instead of noticing errors that need to be corrected. The simple act of caring is heroic. Edward Albert. Facing the shadow. The second stage of the Type 1 growth journey is all about acknowledging and owning your tendency to punish yourself and repress your emotions and instinctual impulses. This helps you realize that your focus on doing things right and improving everything can actually be a bad habit. A big challenge for this type lies in the fact that they try to repress parts of themselves that they believe make them bad or unworthy. They try to be good, but this usually means eliminating any awareness of anything they might judge as bad, including mistakes, uncontained emotional outbursts, normal instinctual impulses, and important human feelings. This lack of self-awareness can make them critical, rigid, and intolerant, even while they consciously think they are being righteous, moral, and virtuous. Ironically, they must learn not to improve, but rather to get worse by accepting the risk or the reality of being bad or wrong, starting with small things. They make progress on their growth journey only when they become less serious and less concerned about doing everything perfectly. Meeting the Type 1 Shadow. If you identify as a Type 1, here are some actions you can take to become more aware of and counteract key Type 1 unconscious patterns, blind spots, and pain points. Lessen your focus on listening to your inner critic and find ways to stop judging yourself and others. Criticism creates more problems than it solves. It adds to your stress and alienates people. Become conscious of the anger underlying your irritability. What is it about? How do you suppress it? How does it leak out when you don't allow yourself to feel it? Embrace anger and learn to see it as positive. Learn to express emotions and impulses actively and notice when you have feelings you don't communicate. Become aware of any impulses you resist and ask yourself why. Be less responsible. Take on fewer duties as urgent priorities and reduce your tendency to micromanage and be excessively detail-oriented. Be more flexible and open to innovation and change. Plan activities that force you to become more spontaneous and less tense. Break the rules, not just the ones you judge as bad rules. Don't judge yourself for making mistakes or worry excessively about the consequences. Work on forgiving yourself more. Engage in activities that allow you to have moments of relaxation and fun. Act on impulses for pleasure and focus more on fun than control. Let yourself be bad. Forget about self-improvement and doing the right thing for a while. There is no light without shadow, and no psychic wholeness without imperfection. C.G. Jung. The Type 1 Blind Spots. This type holds on to the illusion that perfection is possible, achievable, and desirable, and then they criticize themselves for all the inevitable ways they fall short and fail to get it right when trying to meet these impossible standards. Their blind spots tend to hide all the human stuff they don't want to see while they try so hard to do things perfectly. They deny and bury all the messy truths connected to being a normal person in an imperfect world. Type 1 blind spots may include emotions, both good and bad, deep desires to do what they really want to do, and possibly even a secret wish to be bad. They face the challenge of owning and embracing all the parts of themselves they have demonized to justify maintaining control. They may resist acknowledging these blind spots because their default mode is so much about doing the right thing and being a good person. They may fear that chaos and disorder will be unleashed if they accept what they judge as bad in themselves. If you identify as a type 1, here are some unconscious habitual patterns you must bring to the surface, confront, and work to make more conscious to move forward on your journey. Avoiding anger. Do you avoid feeling or expressing your anger? Does your unacknowledged anger sometimes leak out in repressed forms like irritation, tension, stiffness, frustration, annoyance, and self-righteousness? Try some of these techniques to integrate this blind spot. Pay attention to signs of anger or suppressed versions of anger and allow yourself to feel it. Analyze any fears you may have about being angry and make them conscious. Cultivate more conscious awareness of how angry you are. Acknowledge any judgments you make about being angry or expressing anger. Notice and question any beliefs you have about the inappropriateness of feeling angry. Consider how your anger can be channeled in positive ways when made conscious: fighting injustice, establishing boundaries, promoting practices that support good causes, or calling out behavior that hurts people. Recognize and learn to embrace other emotions like sadness, pain, enthusiasm, and joy. When you repress one emotion, you usually push others out of your consciousness as well. Criticizing yourself and others. Do you often catch yourself in the act of criticizing yourself? Do you justify being harsh on yourself based on the idea that self-criticism is necessary to enforce good behavior? Do you frequently criticize others? What happens in your relationships when others feel criticized by you? Here are some actions you can take to integrate this blind spot. Observe yourself closely when your inner critic gets going. What does this feel like? Does it increase your stress level? Allow yourself to feel the hurt you may be inflicting on yourself. Notice when you normalize what amounts to self-punishment. Be more aware of how you enforce your high standards. What beliefs lie behind your tendency to impose these standards on yourself and others? Ask someone you know and trust if they have ever felt criticized by you. Ask them how that made them feel. Inquire into the motives of your inner critic. What assumptions do you make that drive your tendency to be self-critical? What do you fear will happen if you don't criticize yourself? Contemplate whether what you criticize in others is something that you have an unconscious desire to do. Notice how often you tell someone that they are doing something wrong. How do you talk to yourself if you think you have done something wrong? Neglecting relaxation. How often do you allow yourself to rest and relax? What taboos do you have, and regularly enforce, about prioritizing pleasure above duty? How often do you do what you are supposed to do rather than what you would like to do? Here are some actions you can take to integrate this blind spot. Do something you judge as bad. Break the rules. Put off work to go have fun. intentionally do something the wrong way. How does this feel? Tune into your body and really notice how tense you are. For a whole day, inject humor and lightness into everything you say and do. Notice what happens. Notice your tendency to over-control yourself. Observe how you hold back impulses and emotions. What happens as a result? How much energy does this take? Experiment with irresponsibility. What kinds of things do you do every day that you think you must do that you really don't have to do? Spend a whole day having fun and relaxing when you have things to do. Don't do anything you should do. How hard is this? How does it feel? We don't forgive for others. We forgive for ourselves. Desmond Tutu. Type 1 pain. To experience the pain they have avoided by building and identifying with the defensive habits that make up their personality, Type 1s must consciously feel the emotions of their inner child who felt hurt when criticized early on. They must feel all their anger and all of what's beneath it. Any pain or hurt or sadness that came from being punished or pushed to conform to external demands. This type may repress happiness along with other emotions, perhaps fearing that the experience of joy may lead to a dangerous preference for feeling happy over doing things right. They may believe that freedom will lead to disorder and mayhem. But when they acknowledge all their emotions and see them as important and valid, they no longer need to deny the truth of what they feel to uphold impossible standards. This constitutes an important part of their liberation. If you identify with type 1, it can be difficult to acknowledge specific feelings you avoid because you believe them to be inappropriate, wrong, or dangerous. But you must allow yourself to accept these feelings in order to grow. You will ultimately feel better if you can learn to tolerate this specific pain to achieve a fuller realization of your real self. Remember, only zombies feel no pain. Here are some steps you can take to acknowledge and deal with your pain. Become aware of the anger you feel and why you feel it. Explore all the anger derivatives like irritation, frustration, impatience, body tension, and self-righteousness. The more you can experience and study your anger in all its forms, the more free you will eventually feel. Consider the good reasons you have for being angry. Analyze the fear that makes you believe bad things will happen if you allow yourself to acknowledge how angry you really are. Consider how hard you have been on yourself for so long, and feel grief for the child who had to suppress its own natural impulses and instincts to minimize criticism and punishment. Acknowledge the pain behind all your efforts at self-control through self-criticism, the pain of being punished for being bad when you probably weren't really doing anything wrong. Confront the anxiety you feel about making mistakes and the guilt that accompanies your need to control yourself. Explore any feelings of shame and embarrassment you experience when you indulge your natural impulses. Identify any feelings of happiness or joy that you pushed aside because of your need to control yourself. Where there is anger, there is always pain underneath. Eckhart Tolle. The Type 1 Subtypes. Identifying your Type 1 subtype can help you more precisely target your efforts to confront your blind spots, unconscious tendencies, and hidden pain. The specific patterns and tendencies of the subtypes vary depending on which of the three survival instincts dominates your experience. Self-preservation 1 subtype. This subtype experiences the most worry and anxiety and pursues perfection the most aggressively. They usually feel they have to be overly responsible from an early age and so have a fear about survival. They are the most self-critical and least critical of others. They repress anger the most and so don't relate to being angry. Their anger leaks out as body tension, micromanagement, or resentment, or the need to control everything. They are, however, the warmest and friendliest subtype. Social 1 subtype. This subtype is less perfectionist and more perfect, at least from the outside. They focus on finding the right or best way to do things, then teach it to others. They tend to be the most intellectual subtype and may appear superior because they channel their anger into being the owners of truth. They are partly successful at repressing anger, so tend to appear cool and not as anxious. They focus on injustice and working for social causes, but they don't feel comfortable in the middle of a group. They often assume the role of leader to model their own rectitude for others. Sexual 1-to-1, 1 subtype. This is the only type 1 subtype that feels more comfortable with anger. They tend to express anger more than the other subtypes, even though they also sometimes control it. They are more critical of others than they are of themselves, although they are still self-critical. They claim connection to a higher moral authority and are more often reformers than perfectionists. They are zealous when advocating for what they see as right, for what needs to be fixed, and for their right to get what they want. Worry often gives a small thing a big shadow. Swedish proverb. The type 1 subtype shadows. You can more effectively confront your own shadow if you know the specific shadow characteristics of your type 1 subtype. Following are some of the shadow aspects of each subtype. Because the behavior typical of each subtype can be highly automatic, these traits can be hardest to see and own. Self-preservation 1 shadow. If this is your subtype, you maintain a high level of anxiety and worry about everything you do. But you never really feel that things turn out right enough, so you never really...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.